And also controls for, well, 200 actually, the propensity score, potential confounders, and you can see the heading buttons to unity. So, another example where, unless you're very careful, you can be misled by the observation. What about recent changes? So this is a paper that came out in Science at the end of last year, looking at psychological sciences, and they tried to replicate studies. This is that line there was the replication. 53% showed stronger effects in the original study, and the effect size in the replicate was half that in the original study. Another example of the things that we've been talking about, and here were actually replicates that went in the opposite direction. Of course, in the original, almost all were meeting a 0.05 level. In the replicate, only 36% did. And this is interesting. You know, we expect when we do replications, 95% of the effect estimate will be within the confidence intervals of the actual study. Here it was only 41%. So it's actually not just a simple failure to replicate, it's actually a gross failure to replicate. As you might expect, this has been challenged by some of the scientists in psychology, came up and it's been pushed back again at its original authors. 83% of replication, plus that 85% we talked about right at the beginning. In the animal world, it continues to be poorly designed. This cover that they did about our paper was quite interesting. You see down here all the rats, and here we are. And it's a long distance from there to there, isn't it? And that's obviously part of the problem. It's one of the problems why it's so hard to predict to humans rather than models. What's wrong? Well, there aren't enough systematic reviews in animal studies, I've shown you that. Many studies are poorly designed and performed, I've shown you that. They're not adequately reported, and I think this is a state of play that we observed in human studies about 40 years ago. It takes time to catch up. This is looking at trials in 186 trials, 205 Cochrane reviews, trying to using the Cochrane risk of bias tool. Only 16% met low risk of bias, 41% unclear, high risk 43%. So 60% you can clearly say were low risk. And these are the sources of bias. This is actually separation, allocation, confinement, randomization, finding of participants, a little poor performance bar, blending of the outcome assessment, and into high risk of bias. What these authors did was then try and look for how you might adjust these studies to reduce the risk of bias, and found that actually with almost very little cost, very little effort, you could reduce some of these biases by 50%. It's an issue of cost. It's not an issue of ease of doing it. It's actually an issue of money. This is from Ben Goldacre's website in the UK. He continued to look at the protocol stage in trials, what the outcomes say. He looked at 57 trials, 9 reported perfectly compared to the protocol, 300 outcomes not reported, 357 new outcomes silently added. So still continuing problems here. He actually went on and sent letters to the 58 journals pointing out the fact that these publications were different from the protocol and just not possible. And the meta-analysis, again, looking at the median, that discrepancy between protocol and outcome reporting, 31% of trials, and the observational epidemiology, that would be much higher. But some solutions for trying to improve the situation, I want to talk, the first is to reduce the play of chance. I think the play of chance can produce erroneous results. We, of course, always worry about it, but I think that we've greatly underestimated how this can work. Beyond what we would care to attribute to the play of chance, before actually moving on and doing this causality analysis. And clearly, we're not doing this. Recall how liberal a p-value 0.05 is. So in my recent book, I've actually suggested that sigma 2, which is our usual alpha, should be changed. We should be actually looking at 0.01, 0.05, because we are spending so much time and resource following false leads. And data, I think, should always be 0.1. 0.2 is 2. This contradicts, of course, popular epidemiology teaching, which tends to go in the other direction and let's sort of not worry about the p-value. But I think that has led us to some really harmful findings that I've discussed earlier. And I can't think of a single important risk factor that would have been missed by using more stringent p-values. But there are a great many false positive findings that we could have done without. Get rid of that. The American Statistical Association just last month almost talked about the use of this 0.05 level leading to distortion in the scientific process. And I think the discussion should be made about the 0.01. This is from, again, last month. They looked at 4.6 million p-values in 1.6 mining exercises. They concluded most stringent p-value thresholds are probably warranted across cycles. The 0.05 in almost all abstracts suggests that this threshold has lost its discriminating ability, separating false from true hypotheses. And just to go back to Bradford Hill, you should remember, when Bradford Hill was actually writing, doing his work, people in one paper usually studied one hypothesis, just smoking increased risk for lung cancer. We didn't have the computing capacity to study 200 associations in one paper like we did. So, it's a different world. And again, from the American Statistical Association, it's important to know how many and which analyses were conducted. and how they were selected for reporting. So again, now paying more attention to multiple comparisons, which epidemiologists always comment on in their discussion sessions, but rarely correct for. So that's what we often use Bonferroni in genetics. Bonferroni is still frequently used. I know it's false recovery rates and different methods. Bonferroni is simply that. And if people knew the citation to Bonferroni, it would probably be the most cited paper in the biomedical literature. Actually, that's a reference to Bonferroni, and it is very obscure. Bonferroni is quoted about. The issue of larger, better powered trials is not new. It's proposed by Richard Peto. He was a 2002 Gordon awardee, by the way. That's him on the left. It's Richard Daldown sitting down there. And Peto was suggesting if one's trying to decide how billions of future patients should be treated, you need to randomize at least many thousands, hundreds of thousands. And this is what simple large trials are all about. Avoid random errors with large numbers. Detect small or moderate but important defects. Pseudonymize is an easy way using the uncertainty principle. Simplify data collection, analyze and gender bias. How do we reduce bias? Well, the protocol registration obtained absolutely no traction in epidemiology. Widely used in trials, actually required now. Conveniently opposed in epidemiology, the protocol registration should occur. It argues that PhD students have to record a protocol, why not the rest of us? And of course, the same imperative for registering trial protocols applies to other registered trials. And this is still a working problem. There are numerous guidelines being produced, PRISNA, and ARCID guidelines, spirit for protocols, stroke for observational studies, consort for trials. And this is all very helpful. We even have now animal guidelines trials. And these are all actually for reporting guidelines. But of course, if you know how you're expected to report studies, then that should improve study design and conduct. And the NIH has jumped in, and they've got plans to enhance people's usability. And the bits I picked out from this paper, improve training and experimental design, I'll into that. Improve data transparency, that of course is to do with making data systematic evaluation and grant applications, to look at the scientific premise. I just want to expand on that a little bit, the scientific premise. This has got to do with using systematic reviews of extant evidence in the protocol. And this is actually looking at a citation analysis on grant applications. These are the studies that do not support the hypothesis to get one retinal site. These are the studies that do support the application, and of course they got heavily cited. So this is using a non-systematic method of looking at evidence in a protocol. This occurs even when research in the same laboratory is being cited, and somehow don't mention there that we're not successful. This is a change from the protocol for the CRASH trial. The CRASH trial was looking at use of steroids for head injury. And these are the trials that have been done up until that point. If you look at the numbers in these trials, the denominator, you know, 5, 12, 50, 80, 81. I mean, this is a body of evidence that is not going to give you the answer you want. So this is actually many years, 23 years of wasted research. I'll come back to the CRASH trial in a second, but this is how you would like to see evidence presented in a protocol. This is the extant evidence that you're now going to go and test further. Systematically then updating all of the evidence after study completion. Chalmers again and Michael Clark discussed this as islands in search of continents, which is you're putting your findings from your research back into the body of evidence. Misquoting John Bond here, that's okay. They looked at 26 trials. One was the first trial on the questions, so there's obviously nothing to integrate, but only two of the 25 trials actually put their results back into an updated. They updated this finding more recently. 106 trials looked at, 12 were first trials. But again, only three of the 94 to the left.